Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out tonight for this incredible occasion. I'm Matt Carey, the documentary editor at Deadline.com. Please join me in welcoming the directors of the film, Jesse Short Poe and Laura Tomaselli. And we are also very pleased to be joined by the executive producer, Sarah Eagle. Congratulations on a really extraordinary film. I'm going to start just to get with you, Laura, and ask how this project came about.
Yeah, well, you know, again, it's the power of story. And I think what provided the initial spark was a news article that our producer, Benjamin Dean, had read that talked about the court case, the longest standing court case in United States history. And that set the curiosity in motion, and it just built out from there.
Sarah, I wonder if you could talk about, you grew up on the reservation in South Dakota. What is it like to be in the Black Hills? For those who are in the audience, go and then know what's the feeling that you get when you're there.
Well, to be honest, so I grew up on Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. I grew up on the eastern side of Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. It's actually a 2-hour drive from my part of the reservation to the Black Hills. So when I was growing up, I didn't actually have a lot of access to the Black Hills. And I feel like that's part of it, right? Because the closest grocery store where it's affordable is 2 hours away from where I was living. And so for me to be in the Black Hills, it was actually a luxury. It wasn't something that you get every day. And then also at that point, we didn't have land at all. None of the tribes had land in the Black Hills at that point either.
Mm-hmm. Laura, can you talk about the pace of the film? This is, I think, unusual for a documentary. To me, it felt like a river.
That's such a beautiful way to describe it. I think that one of the things that unified Jesse and myself when we first started talking is there's a version of this movie that I think everyone understands is going to be this joke that is talking heads, that is people saying the Treaty of Fort Laramie of 1868, you know, that is like that. We didn't want to do that. I think that we knew that it had to be dynamic in a lot of ways to do justice to the story, but also I think to a lot of what we're doing in this movie is, or part of what we're doing in this movie is sort of going against sort of the propaganda that Western, classic Hollywood Westerns have influenced American culture and stuff like that. And so we wanted to make something grand that was dramatic and that wasn't a staged sort of quiet documentary.
The use of clips of Hollywood films is very important, and we see The Searchers, which I found myself thinking, wow, this is kind of like Birth of a Nation in terms of mythologizing things, but you know, in a very destructive way, arguably. Just can you talk about the use of the film clips, and I don't think you use them in a typical way in documentary. Like normally it would be sound up, oh, here's a scene. Oftentimes you're taking some of the sound out, you're using it in a somewhat different way than a typical documentary.
Yeah, and I think that part of that is, obviously Laura's just amazing creative intuition, but the other part is like, it follows like Lady, which is looking at language from every viewpoint that you can, up, down, side to side, the space in between letters, through a poet's lens. And I think that Laura wrote that and integrated it so well that you can't deny when you see that scene with Custer and the general, and he just flat plain his face, you know, this is plain robbery. And so using those clips and turning them in against each other, because that was a damaging time lot of our people developed a powerful self-hatred from that boarding school era, and then emboldened by the imagery that they seen on the screen. So we really wanted to turn that in on itself and present it for what it really was, which is something that was terrible.
And Lord, I'd like to ask about the sound design, the sound mixing in the visuals, and there are particularly some, for me anyway, very striking moments. There's one where you're doing a dissolve from like wagons, aerial shot to ants on the mound. I mean, that's just a really stunning shot. And in terms of audio, there's the clip of Calamity Jane with Doris Day and Howard Keel. And how you fade the audio out is haunting. And you hear sort of echo of that and other visuals.
I think audio is really important to me as an editor. I'm going to say something trite, but I think that visuals are maybe what's happening, but I think a lot of times audio is us telling you how to feel about it. One of the early, I think, footholds we had was Lele, you mentioned, I don't know if you talked about Lele Long Soldier yet, but it was certainly Lele Long Soldier, the tone of her voice, the pacing of her voice. But also, we were lucky enough to work with Grady on the score. He was very generous in giving us a lot of different drone elements, a lot of different sound design elements, so we really could layer it everywhere and make it all kind of flow together. Mm.
In terms of, I'm curious about your sense of whether we're at a turning point, Sarah, because that's in some ways the crux of the film, as a culture.
I guess I would say I pray to God we're at a turning point, honestly. I feel like I spent a lot of time in Los Angeles in my career life. I grew up on the reservation. I moved away when I was 21. And I spent probably just as much time in LA as I have growing up on the reservation. And going home during COVID, I was shocked at the racism. I really was, because I think part of me hoped that it had gotten better, and it didn't. I think that what you see in the film is the truth and much worse. Actually, they were kind in the film, to be honest. They were kind. And I was at the protest. And I was standing next to the man that holds the big sign, right? I was standing next to him, wearing a ribbon skirt, and these people were horrible people. And I think as a Native woman walking in that space, like I definitely was worried for my safety. And I couldn't do normal things in South Dakota that I could do in LA, like park my car, put up a tent, even drive in some cases, like cousins that have been chased by like white men in vehicles. Like this stuff happens, and I don't think enough people understand that that's the reality of what Native women have to deal with in conservative areas today. So I pray to God that we're at a crossroads.
Just can you talk about your experience growing up and the other testimony in the film? Also, was similar to what you experienced?
Yeah. I'll say that I grew up in a border town, and I noticed that there's a powerful guilt in communities that are closest to the reservation that are non Lakota, and that powerful guilt tends to create really negative things. And I think that, and it was even more confusing for me because my dad is a Oglala tribal member and my mom's a non-native. So I had one eye on each side, and I listened to both of them, listened to both sides. And the thing that it boiled down for me was there was a terrible, it was hard because nobody ever wanted to talk about any of these things. Nobody wanted to address them. And like Sarah said, I still do feel nervous about going back home, and you know, the people that we show, because it is threatening to some, and they will see this as a threatening message. So that does make me nervous, but at the same time, I think that, like you mentioned, there does seem to feel like a shift is coming, and I really hope that that's for good, because I really love living back home, and I want to see my relatives have a good life, and that's the biggest goal, you know. And that is not threatening. It shouldn't be threatening to anybody.
That's a wonderful point. And I think it also fits with a sort of discussion in the film about the, and reframing the idea of reparations as repair, which is not something I had heard before, but it's really quite profound. And taken in that spirit is to the benefit of all. One of you talked about the importance of addressing that in the film.
I wanted to suggest it to not like I thought this weren't things to say about it, but I think a lot of terms like reparations, like critical race theory, they become these demonized, easy, terrifying terms. Just to make people never understand what they're gonna mean. And so I think that one of the things that Jesse and I wanted to do in putting this film together is not point fingers at people in terms of you did this, but rather say you're responsible for what happens after this. You know what I mean? Action and inaction are the same kind of choice. And so I think that part of what we're doing in talking about reparations is what Jesse's saying. It's not a scary thing, regardless of what weight that word might hold in popular culture. You know, was reframing it as something positive for everybody, not just indigenous people. You know, this hurts all of us, okay?
And Sarah, I think one of the things that has shifted the conversation culturally is climate change. Because I think we see powerfully in this film the Lakota view of the land as something living, and that the land is life-giving, and it is the Western mentality of the land is private property to be used, to be extracted from, has got us into the situation we're in now. And I think hopefully, I mean, there's going to have to be a kind of reckoning with ancient indigenous wisdom that had been adhered to, we would not be in this situation.
Right. I mean, for this film in particular, I think that, I tease Laura a lot because, like, the first edit that I saw, I had like 20 notes. And I don't know that that's normal in a film to have like that many notes at the beginning, but that was it. It was like the spirituality, it was like the connection to the land, it was that piece of it. And I think that for Lakota people, understanding that our connection to this birthplace, it's our birthplace of where we emerge from the earth. And I think so many people forget about that connection, and we've not. And it still is, as we live amongst these days of like the hottest days on the earth, and you know, and we're thinking about, you know, how do we actually preserve the earth and preserve our sacred sites. I think it's a very important message in the film. And I think that connection to spirituality, to our language, to our value system, as I shared earlier, not values, because Lakota laws, they were laws. There were consequences to not following these values. So I think it's really important to educate our own people. And not just, I mean, so for us, it's also, Jesse and I were just on a Kiwi radio, our home radio station, yesterday, all of us were. And part of it is, I think that as a Lakota person, you're raised to help understand that your job is to help your people. Like, I'm raised with the understanding of Ndakwe Oyase. How do I help my people? And so I really felt with this film that I could look back on my life and say, okay, I tried to help my people. And like, if I died tomorrow, right? Like, I could feel like I help my people to understand this and future generations, because we want our young people to understand that close connection between our birthplace, our Lakota laws, and also like this place that we call like Nchimaka, like our grandmother earth, and our role in preserving and protecting this place.
We will open it up to questions in just a moment, but in what you're thinking of them, I would just wanted to mention also a moment that really brought me to tears. It's just stunning. It's this extraordinary story of the young woman who rides her horse 240 miles. Oh my God, it's really so powerful. Jesse, obviously, it was for you just to see that.
Yeah, for sure. And Alex was a friend of mine from years ago, but at the time went on, we go our different paths. And when Standing Rock was happening, and I think it really captivated a lot of our communities. And what I saw that day, as I think about it in a historical perspective, that our ancestors going up against the military, going up against the fighting force, and today, when she and the others, they had no idea what to do with the horses, the police, the sheriff's department. They knew how to keep everybody back, but the horses were introduced as an element that they didn't have probably training for. And so they retreated. And I saw that as a victory for the Lakota people in all the times of conflict that we've had to endure. I seen that as another victory. So when everybody cleared away and the time was gone, I went and took some rocks from that approach, because I knew that was a special moment. And I think Alex, who I think just embodies so much of Lakota virtues, who would probably never, ever, ever tell anybody that that even happened. If, you know, she would never go out and say, oh yeah, I did this, I did that. She wouldn't do that ever. And that's why I thought that maybe it would be good to try to remember that story, because that's a significant victory.
It's an incredible moment in the film. Are there questions from the audience? Thank you, Shai. Okay, so yeah, in the center there. Yes, you go ahead. Question you can hear is about national parks and how non-Lakota people should interact with national parks.
Yeah, and I'm glad that you asked that, because you know I grew up right next to a national park, Badlands National Park. It's a little strange, you know. I think that our tribal leadership really nurtured an agreement specifically with, like, say, the Badlands National Park, and not so much in the other national parks within the area, like Wind Cave, for example, but the Badlands specifically, they have nurtured an agreement amongst the two. Now, even that, you look at that original agreement, is still probably not up to a standard that we could be satisfied with. So with that being said, I will also say that I personally am not satisfied, especially maybe within the national parks in South Dakota specifically, the integration of Lakota mindset, worldview, history, you know, any of those things, I am not satisfied with that. I am grateful that the land is protected. I am grateful that you can go into the land and as a person, you know, be able to go there. That I like, but I'm still very, there needs to be a lot more improvement in that regard.
And I would add to that, so I also work for a nonprofit, Maternal Heart Foundation, and we've done a lot of work, and we had retreats in the Black Hills, and so I had the opportunity to interact with different parks staff. And there's a lot of different dynamics happening right now, right, because I think that with Secretary Deb Haaland in the space that she's at and of influence, right, there's also this level of trying to get Park Service to understand Lakota spirituality, indigenous spirituality and value systems, and so she's working really hard in that arena. At the same time, most of the staff of these park systems in South Dakota are not Native. And so you see that disconnect in the teachings that actually happens in our community and our birthplace, you know, when cave, you see that disconnect very clearly. And so we have a long ways to go in ensuring that our voice and perspective and also like our spirituality and religion is respected in these places.
Other questions? Oh, thank you very much.
Yes.
Beautiful film, by the way. I guess my question is, I'm sure making this film with an emotional journey.
You're close, don't
Okay. Hi. I guess my question is, I'm sure this film was an emotional journey. Watching it, I got emotional myself a few times, especially you guys were talking about the horse that made me the most emotional throughout the film. I guess my question is, while making this film, what was the most emotional impact to each one of you? Like, whether it be happiest, saddest, or angriest?
I'll start first, just because like I have my example ready to go. The part that I tear up over every single time is obviously when the Lakota elder Miloyola here says, "Every dog deserves respect." That part, because he encompasses so much of the racial dynamic in South Dakota in one sentence. And for me, as somebody that has grown up on the reservation, has gone to college there, has lived and worked in these spaces, like, and has felt the racial dynamic there of just discrimination, racial profiling, like, even for my own sons and like my family, like my relatives, like for me, that was, like I said earlier, it was shocking. And I think for an elder to still be saying that at his age, of an elder saying that every, even a dog deserves respect, says so much to me as a Lakota person. And that part, I tear up every single time I watch in a film.
Question? Yes.
Hi,
Hi.
I'm
I just wanted to say before I throw it to Sarah to answer the detailed part of that question. I want to say yes, I think yes, it can happen, and yes, it will happen. I think that being in that mindset, supporting that mindset, working towards that mindset is the only way that it can happen. So I think through this film, I think we have heard a lot, how is this possible, and it is possible. I think that pressure, you know, in the 70s and 80s, as we see in this film, it's, unless you hold the government's feet to the fire, things can't happen. But I think our goal with this film, one of the things Jesse says brilliantly is it's a historical resource, it's an educational resource, it's also a tool to try and gather enough support to really make some movement.
Yeah, so we do have a social impact component of this film. If you go to blackhillsjustice.org, that's where we're tracking everything, so you can sign up for our newsletter and be a part of that movement. I think part of it for us, and we have our whole Lakota side of it that has been working and organizing with different tribal communities, our role is to follow tribal leaders, tribal elders, treaty council members. And so as much as we've had a lot of different people come in sort of what I would say is like white savior mode and say like, oh yeah, just get an executive order, get like this, get Wind Cape back, or get like this little people. Well, in reality of Lakota people, we all know that like if you get one piece, say like Wind Cape, which is very, very small, tiny part of our entire like Black Hills, they are not gonna go for that. They do not want just one piece of our land back, even though that's our birthplace. They want all of it back. And we know that we have to follow the lead of our treaty council.